I was working with an American shamanic guy, and he had somebody who would come to see him that was in real dire straits. And over the course of about a week, he became more and more difficult to deal with. He exhibited more and more dangerous behaviors. Now, among the different spirits you can be possessed by in Brazil, they have one that's just the category would be obsessive suffering spirits. And they're usually attracted to people suffering, like a moth to the flame, and they come and they intensify your suffering in order to feed off of it. And that's what we had eventually decided that this young man was dealing with. My guy had tried what he could do to extract these spirits unsuccessfully. And so he decided he needed to call in help. And so he started asking around, who should I bring this young man to? And the advice was unanimous, you have to take them to the Valley of the Dawn. And this was in Piranopolis, Brazil, which is a smaller town than our speaker will speak of tonight, but there was a church there. So they organized a group exorcism. And we got him there, and that was how I came to be involved in a group exorcism in Brazil. So cut to October that same year, and I'm standing in the hallway where my office is, and I see a poster for a presentation on space-time travelers. I've lost her thing here. Of the Valley of the Dawn, and I said, wait a minute, that's the group that I was involved with when I was there. And then I looked at who was presenting this. This was down in the zoo, and it was Dr. Kelly Hayes. And I said, she's my friend from graduate school. Now I know what happened to her. It's Intergalactic Space Time Travelers. So now I know what happened to Kelly Hayes, and apparently we have now wound up at the same place doing the same thing over time. So I was not able to attend her talk at the zoo because I was going to Minneapolis to do mind-body medicine training, which is not unlike what we're going to see here a little bit. But I said, I bet I can get Kelly to come to Truman and give the same talk here, so I'll get to hear it, and we'll share it with everybody else. And so that is why I am happy to introduce today Dr. Kelly Eileen Hayes. Just for her bona fides, she got her PhD in Divinity from the University of Chicago Divinity School in 2004, but even before she got her PhD, impressively, she was at Indiana University where she continues. She's been there since 2002. She's received two Fulbrights, but the one that she received that this work has culminated from, she received in 2012. She is also the author of a book called Holy Harlots, Femininity, Sexuality, and Black Magic in Brazil. And if we don't have it in the library, I will surely order it soon. And it also comes with a film that she collaborated on called Slaves of the Saints. So with that introduction, I'd like us to give a warm welcome to Kelly Hayes.
Thank you all. I had no idea there were so many people collaborating to bring me here, so I really want to thank you. It's such a great joy for me to reunite with Derek and to come and visit you in Kirksville, and I've had a wonderful time so far, so thank you very much. Thanks, of course, to Derek, particularly for bringing me into the Global Issues Colloquium. So, as Derek mentioned, this is a new research project for me, so I'm right now working on a book, and this is kind of preliminary work that I'm pulling together right now, so hopefully this will be eventually a chapter. While Brazil is known in the U.S. primarily for its stunning natural beauty and exuberant traditions of music, dance, and futebol, less well known is the country's religious effervescence. If there's one unifying characteristic of Brazilian culture, aside perhaps from Brazilians' love of soccer, it might well be what one writer called a fervent and restless spiritual life. With a variety of imported and homegrown alternatives available to the contemporary seeker, Brazil today is second only to the U.S. in its religious diversity. Much of the discussion in the U.S. about the country's changing religious landscape has focused on the rapid expansion of Pentecostal Protestantism and the decline of Catholicism over the last several decades. But this same time period has also witnessed the growth of distinctively new religious movements characterized by eclectic and imaginative syntheses, from Santo Daime, whose adherents celebrate the Eucharist by consuming a hallucinogenic brew of indigenous origin, which Professor Dashke can talk about in his classes, right? To a variety of Japanese Brazilian religions, to a broad panorama of spiritualist, esoteric, and New Age influenced groups promising self-realization and cosmic transformation. One of the most intriguing examples of Brazil's culturally eclectic, restlessly creative religious imagination is the movement known as Valley of the Dawn. A striking aspect of the valley's cosmology is how it synthesizes a remarkably wide range of influences into an aesthetic style and a master narrative in which valley members share a collective identity that spans past, present, and future. And in this slide, you can maybe get a sense for the symbolic diversity. So there's a Star of David, Jesus, the sun and the moon. You can't actually see the sun on the temple. This is the main temple of the valley right outside of Brasília. The valley's narrative is one of the foundations of what I'll call an imaginative world, which is materialized or made concretely real for participants through a large number of aesthetic and kinesthetic experiences, of which I'll discuss a few examples. The valley's imaginative world strikes most outsiders as fantastical, if not bizarre. The mainstream press in the US and in Brazil usually describe it as a cult, although it is not a cult in the popular understanding of that term. Such labels are not only misleading, they preclude us from taking alternative religions like the Valley seriously. A better way of understanding the Valley's appeal is to look at the larger historical and social context in which it's located and what its imaginative world offers the people who share that context. In order to do so, I'll contrast the Valley with the city of Brasília, the planned capital in whose shadow the Valley was founded. Both propose a radically utopian vision for society and a master plan for achieving it. The correspondences and disjunctures of their respective models give us some insight into the Valley and why so many are drawn to it. The Valley's mother temple is located in one of the many nondescript satellite cities flanking the Brazilian capital. The town that has grown up around the temple, also called Valley of the Dawn, is home to around 40,000 people, most of whom are involved in the religion. But with 600 affiliated temples throughout Brazil, as well as Portugal, Germany, Japan, Bolivia, Uruguay, and even here in the United States, the Valley is much more than a local Brazilian religion. It's an international new religious movement with close to 500,000 followers worldwide. So this makes it larger than a lot of better known religions like Rastafarianism, certainly Scientology. The Valley is known officially as Social Works of the Christian Spiritualist Order. It was founded in 1965 by an itinerant truck driver and clairvoyant named Neiva Zelaya, or as her followers affectionately refer to her, Chia Neiva. And Chia means aunt, so Aunt Neiva. Shortly after Chia Neiva established this religious community, she joined forces with Mario Sassi, an early convert who renounced his family and former life to become Neiva's companion, lover, and the intellectual codifier of her visions. Images of the two are featured in many places throughout the valley. As its official name suggests, the Valley's basic doctrinal framework is derived from spiritualism, the belief that after death, the individual continues to live on in disembodied form in a spiritual realm and can communicate with and even influence the living via dreams, through trained mediums, and in possession trance. According to the Valley, some highly evolved spirits work on behalf of humanity as mentors, while other lower level spirits can provoke illness and misfortune. And in this image, we see a Valley adept with a portrait of one of his highly evolved spirit mentors. Woven into this basic framework are elements drawn not only from Christianity, primarily the belief in Jesus as the human incarnation of God who offers a path for redemption, but also the Hindu concepts of karma and reincarnation, spirit entities that are venerated in Afro-Brazilian religions, ideas and vocabulary drawn from various esoteric traditions, principally theosophy, as well as the belief in extraterrestrial life forms and intergalactic space travel. So this is a piece of artwork made by a Valley member that, again, I think gives you a little bit of an idea of the various religious and cultural systems and symbols that the Valley draws on. So this and the next three slides are artwork made by Valley members. Okay, so we have all these different influences. How do they all fit together? In brief, Valley members believe they're part of a unique tribe whose spiritual ancestors derived from a race of extraterrestrials originally sent to Earth over 30,000 years ago with a mission from God to advance humanity's cultural and spiritual evolution. Led by a highly advanced spirit known as Father White Arrow, these extraterrestrials and their spiritual descendants were responsible for the evolutionary progression of modern Homo sapiens from earlier species, as well as the technologically advanced constructions of Machu Picchu, ancient Egypt, Easter Island, and other architectural wonders. Over the millennia, these spirits passed through multiple lifetimes in different historical eras and places, incarnating as Spartan warriors, Egyptian royals, Roman legionnaires, Russian gypsies, French revolutionaries, and colonial Brazilians, among others. Valley members believe that Chia Neva has reunited them at the Valley in order to complete their mission. So here it says, cradle of the unification of roots, Brazil. In honor of their incarnation as a band of Incan warriors led by Father White Arrow at the beginning of Spanish colonization, Valley members refer to themselves collectively as jaguars, an identity symbolized by a stylized feline face patterned after that found on some Incan monuments. So here you see it on the entrance to the temple, but you'll see it in various other forms throughout the slides that I'm going to show. Father White Arrow himself, as his name might suggest, is depicted as an Indian chief in honor of his final appearance on Earth. As Chia Neva's chief spiritual mentor, Father White Arrow is the spiritual patron of the Valley. The sum total of all the Jaguars' various incarnations across time and space is known as the community's transcendental heritage, kind of karmic ledger of past lives, deeds and misdeeds, and their karmic consequences. The advent of Jesus marked a turning point in the Jaguars' collective history, making possible a form of karmic redemption that the Valley calls the Christic system. By exemplifying Jesus' teachings of unconditional love, humility, and forgiveness, Valley members believe that they, and all human beings, can atone for past errors and return to the path of God. The community's ritual life centers on facilitating healing and karmic atonement on an individual, collective, and even planetary level. This massive endeavor involves a repertoire of nearly 50 different rituals, referred to as spiritual works, that occur nearly round the clock, 365 days a year, some multiple times a day, others on a weekly, monthly, or a yearly schedule. In order to ensure their smooth performance, the Valley has instituted a complex bureaucracy of offices and procedures in which all participants have a role to play. While each of these spiritual works is unique in its details, they can be divided into two general kinds. The first First are rituals of spiritual healing aimed at alleviating human suffering. These are understood to exemplify the Christic values of unconditional love and compassion and are offered free of charge to all who seek them. The Valley estimates that up to 12,000 people a month visit the Mother Temple for healing. But there are temples in every Brazilian state, and so probably the number across the country is much larger. But having been there, I can tell you that that number is about right. According to the Valley, a significant source of illness and suffering is obsessing spirits, so the same kind of spirits that Derek was talking about just a minute ago, that attach themselves to people and provoke all manner of problems. Spirit healing rituals are intended to indoctrinate these troublesome spirits and guide them to their appropriate place on the ethereal plane so that they may continue to follow their own evolutionary path. The second set of rituals, performed for the benefit of initiated members, is intended to redeem the participant's own negative karma and that generated by key episodes in the Jaguar's transcendental heritage. This set of rituals is understood to manipulate spiritual energies in order to liquidate karmic debts accumulated in the past. Members learn how to manipulate spiritual energies in a series of development courses taught by trained mediums. These are arranged in a hierarchical series of ranks and initiatory levels, and there are about seven at least of these different levels that you progress through. As the individual completes these courses, he or she earns the right to wear specific clothing and insignia, participate in specific rituals, and take on certain duties in accordance with their position within the Valley's complex, multi-level bureaucracy. These courses also expose initiates to the details of their shared history as jaguars and their mission of advancing humanity's spiritual evolution. There's a certain urgency to the Valley's mission. Like other millennial and new age groups, Valley members believe that we are on the cusp of a new era, referred to as the third millennium, when the earth will enter a new phase and the era of karmic redemption will close. So this is another piece made by a Valley member, and it says, "We're on the brink of the third millennium, and we have to sharpen our claws. It's the time of religion, of the disintegration of forces, and we cannot forget, even for a moment, of the figure of Jesus, the Wayfarer, and his holy gospel." So Valley members consider themselves Christians, which other Christians don't really like. So I want to return to this particular envisioning of the New Age a little bit later. But for now, we can observe how the Valley integrates an array of religious ideas and pop culture memes. Everything from beliefs about the mystical significance of the ancient pyramids and the space age fascination with extraterrestrial life to millennial expectations into a sweeping narrative that puts adherents at the front and center of a cosmic drama unfolding across the frontiers of time and space. In short, the Jaguars were the movers and shakers throughout human history and are at the center of God's plan for the universe. In the course of their passage through history, they also generated negative karma that must be addressed in order to complete their mission. The Valley offers adherents more than just an all-encompassing storyline, however. One of the most striking things about the religion is how it works to materialize this basic story, and I've actually simplified it quite a bit, both in its complex ritual and administrative bureaucracy, but also through a kind of all-encompassing aesthetic and kinesthetic immersion that involves all of the senses. So if you came in a little bit earlier, I was playing some hymns, which you will hear around the clock at the Valley. So we have hymns that have special incense that they burn. You have this profusion of symbols, which I hope you've gotten sort of a sense of that through the slides. Colors, badges, costumes. If you begin to pay attention, particularly to the women's costumes, there are multiple variations, and everything on the costume, the colors, the symbols, has a particular meaning. The Valley has also developed a unique architectural style, a pastiche that to the untrained eye seems to draw equal inspiration from the aesthetics of the mini golf course, Legoland, and the theatrical production of the musical Hair. The temple complex includes a number of specialized color-coded built environments where rituals are performed, including a sizable man-made lake in the form of a six-pointed star. And this is the lake of the forward part. This is where the ritual of the burning star, the Estrella Candente, perhaps the most well-known of the valley's repertoire, takes place three times a day in accordance with the arrival of a fleet of invisible spacecraft, according to valley members. In an arrangement brokered by Chianeva, the spacecraft transport spirits deformed by the great evil they wrought during their lifetimes so that valley members can clean up their karma and help set them on the path to God. The lake's water is a vital element in this purification process. On the opposite side of the lake is a pyramid-shaped building, which you might have noticed in some earlier slides, whose inner walls are crowded with portraits of individual members' spirit mentors. The pyramid references the jaguar's time in ancient Egypt, and is a, quote, powerful integrator and disintegrator of forces, as valley members like to say. A short distance away is the temple itself. Built in the form of an ellipse, the temple is divided into sectors, each dedicated to a particular type of ritual and possessing its own predominant color. So this is inside the temple. If you were to visit as a patient, this would be the first stop that you would go to, where you would consult plethu value spirits, spirits of elderly black slaves that would be incorporated in the mediums who work at the valley. And I suspect something like that happened with your friend. So this is inside the temple as well. The vibrant color scheme continues throughout. This is another ritual area. The rituals themselves are structured as performative enactments involving choreographed gestures and bodily postures, courtly processions, invocations, hymns, implements, costumes, and accessories. Each requires multiple actors, and the valley posts a work schedule monthly in order to ensure that the posts are filled. As you might imagine, the result of all of this is a full-bodied experience which offers adherents total sensory immersion in an imaginative world, an enchanted world that is understood to be a reflection of the spiritual realities revealed and brought to the terrestrial world by Chianeva. Now, just to be clear, I think all religions construct imaginative worlds, but I have not encountered any that are as elaborately realized and lavishly produced as the valleys. But the Valley of the Dawn is not solely the product of the visionary mind of its founder. It also reflects the historical and social context of its emergence. Like the modernist city of Brasília, of which it is both a satellite and, as anthropologist James Holston has suggested, its spiritual counterpart in certain ways, the Valley was founded on a utopian premise, the idea of breaking with the past and all of its baggage or karmic debts in order to create a different future. Brasília and the Valley share other similarities. The next slides are all of Brasília. Both materialize in the form of their constructed environments, an imaginative world whose inhabitants are invited to work towards the realization of a new era. Both were founded at almost the same time. In many ways, the Valley's in dialogue both with the ideal of Brazil that Brasília represents, and what has turned out to be the far messier reality. But I believe the Valley succeeds in ways that Brasília, and Brazil more generally, has not. built in a little over 3 years. I don't know if you can see this very well, but the city is built in the shape of an airplane. Built in a little over 3 years, Brasília was intended to inaugurate a new modern era for Brazil and to catapult the country from the third to the first world. The new capital's utopian character was invested from the start with spiritual significance. As its planners noted, the city's location corresponded to the 19th century Italian mystic João Bosco's prophecy about a promised land flowing with milk and honey that would be revealed in the South American interior. So let's go back to the late 1950s. The setting is a vast plateau in the sparsely populated central Brazilian interior, where construction begins on a new, futuristic capital city. As envisioned by its designers, Lúcio Costa and Oscar Niemeyer, Brasília was to be a living monument, not to prophetic revelation, but to the tenets of rationality. They divided the city into quadrants and sectors according to function, residential housing in one area, government buildings in another, hotels, banks, commercial businesses, and so forth, each in their own separate sector. In order to ensure the unimpeded flow of traffic, they designed an interlocking series of roads linked by cloverleaf interchanges, which, in addition to eliminating traffic lights, also eliminated crossroads and the public life of the streets. From the vantage point of the 1950s, the future belonged to the automobile. As an exemplar of progress for the rest of the nation, Brasília also was intended to produce the modern citizen. In his book, The Modernist City, anthropologist James Holston shows how everything from the layout of the streets to the arrangement of buildings and their architectural forms was supposed to create the values that informed them: egalitarianism, universality, progress, order. Housing units were standardized. Bus drivers and government officials alike were to live as neighbors, a radical break from the long-standing class stratifications and tensions of Brazilian society. The idea was that the past could be abolished through master planning, and as new, more modern forms of sociality emerged in this new environment, the future would be realized. No affordable housing was built for the workers who actually constructed the city, since it was designed to engender a classless civitas. Brasília was intended to be a modern utopia for the modern citizen, one governed by reason, where the bureaucracy of the secular state guaranteed equality and justice for all. Aunt Neiva was one of the many Brazilians who migrated to the Federal District to work in the construction of the new capital city. She arrived in 1957, recently widowed and with four young children. Her first job in Brasília was transporting migrant workers in her truck, and the origin story that has developed around the valley emphasizes Neiva's status as Brazil's first female truck driver. Not long after arriving, Neiva began to suffer from visual and auditory hallucinations that persisted until her death in 1985. Initially terrified, she soon became convinced that they were visitations from various spiritual and extraterrestrial beings, among them Father White Arrow. Following that entity's directions, Aunt Neiva established a small spiritual community in 1959. 10 years later, after the dissolution of that group and convinced that she had been chosen to prepare humanity for the third millennium, Neiva, together with Mario Sassi, established the Valley of the Dawn in a rural area outlying the capital. Despite the optimistic future the construction of Brasília seemed to herald, soon after the new capital's official inauguration in 1960, political chaos engulfed the country. In 1964, a right-wing military faction seized power, and the city, built on a progressive vision of modernity, became the seat of a repressive authoritarian regime. 2 decades of military rule and a series of boom and bust economic cycles followed. Meanwhile, a few kilometers away, Aunt Neiva and Mario Sassi served a population largely left behind in the rush towards modernity: migrant workers, made jobless after the completion of Brasília, struggling rural families, abandoned children, and all manner of ill, mentally disturbed, and destitute inhabitants of the poverty-ridden satellite cities that developed around the outskirts of the capital. But the community also attracted people from the middle sectors, government functionaries, teachers, bank clerks, civil servants, disillusioned by the ever-widening gap between the ideal state that Brasília was supposed to usher into being and the frustrating realities of daily life. Because despite its master plan, Brasília did not engender a new civitas. The past could not be abolished by rearranging the built environment. Justice and equality could not magically be produced by the performative enactments of architecture and urban planning. The bureaucracy of the state continued to function, as it always had, on behalf of elite interests, and those who were excluded continued to be relegated to the periphery. This is the second largest favela, or shantytown, in the country, which is 30 kilometers from the presidential palace, the Palácio do Planalto. Among other things, the valley offers its members an orderly world that works, a bureaucracy that functions, a hierarchy through whose ranks all can rise by dint of effort, a form of work in which people feel that they achieve something positive and valuable, a place where everyone has access to resources that lead to greater self-awareness, self-discipline, and dignity. Perhaps more importantly, the valley gives its adherents a sense that they can understand and control their lives, something that is often difficult to achieve in modern Brazil. To a person, the valley members that I've interviewed emphasize the sense of fulfillment and inner peace that they derive from their spiritual work. They appreciate the development of self-awareness and spiritual growth that the valley encourages, and its emphasis on humility and compassion. As one woman told me, the valley, quote, teaches you to know yourself and to know your spiritual powers. Without demagoguery, without thinking that you're better than anyone else, it teaches you that you yourself are your biggest treasure, your conscience, your mind, your spirit. And this empowers you so that through the lessons you learn by living out the doctrine, you see what you can improve in your life and how you can correct the errors of the past. You see that the pain of the other person is always greater than your own. While the valley respects the individual and recognizes free will, people are not seen as self-creating, autonomous monads free of the entanglements of the past. Rather, they are equal members of a larger community who share both a past and a transcendent purpose. And in contrast to valley members' daily experiences as Brazilians, as jaguars, they are at the center of history and society, not its margins. The valley is a capital in its own right, the center of a global spiritual empire oriented towards collective redemption. In other words, the valley is the ideal of Brasília transposed to the spiritual plane. In key ways, the valley models an alternative to the modernist project as it took form in Brazil, a project symbolized most concisely in the state's master plan for its capital city. Unlike that project, which tried to abolish the past in order to create a new future, the valley does not negate history, but proposes that we must confront the past and its errors in order to produce the future that we desire. To be sure, the valley's version of history is not that of historians. It's a mythological narrative, that is, a story that's not about events per se, but about their meaning. The mainstream view, both in the US and in Brazil, sees the valley as a kooky cult, and Brasília as an audacious, if problematic, work of genius. What people fail to see is that the valley helps people realize the very ideals that Brasília was supposed to accomplish, an orderly world, structured by the principles of equality and justice, in which all participants are able to evolve through hard work and merit. The irony of Brasília is that the past had no place in its vision of the new era. And in this refusal to recognize the weight of history, it ended up reproducing the very same inequalities, the same debts and crimes of the past. From the perspective of the Valley members, unless this negative karma is transformed, it will continue to determine not only Brazil's present, but also its future. Thank you very much.
We have time for questions. I don't know if there's a microphone.
No.
Okay, so I'll field questions. I'm going to turn up the lights a little bit, and then
presentation, I mean, I would say it's more library. The history of Brasília and all of that. But in general, my work is probably way more ethnographic than literature. There's not a whole lot of literature on the Valley. There is more in Portuguese, mostly dissertations. There's practically nothing in English. There's no book in English, for example. There are pieces here and there.
You've emphasized the way that the local environment, particularly the history and connection with Brasília and so forth, has shaped what the Valley does, what they believe and so forth. But you also pointed out earlier that this is a religion that's kind of worldwide in many respects. So it must have appeal to a number of people who are not as much embedded in Brazilian history. What do you see as the more universal aspects of the appeal of the religion?
Mm-hmm. I think the universal aspects are about healing, really. I mean, it centers on healing, and most people get involved with the religion because they sought healing there. So, I mean, the Valley's cosmology gets super complex, and like if you're intellectually inclined, you can go there and be very happy figuring it all out. But like, you could enter at various levels, and for lots of people that I talked to, they really feel like it gives them a way to understand things happening in their lives. So how to understand your string of bad luck, or the fact that you have this relationship of a lot of conflict with family members. Well, in a past life, right, you were spirits and you had some kind of history. So they like it for that reason. Lots of people reject Roman Catholicism's understanding of sin and an afterlife, so this makes sense to them in that way. Lots of people are attracted by the core values of compassion, humility, and unconditional love. I think lots of people are attracted because lots of people like to dress up. And really, I mean, I think we shouldn't underestimate that, like particularly in Brazil. At the Valley, you don't know who's a street sweeper and who's a lawyer, and I've met both people. And people take a lot of pride in their costumes and really feel like royalty. And indeed, they're supposed to sort of represent their highest spiritual self. And so I think it fulfills a lot of things. I think for people in the U.S., I haven't had a chance to visit the temple here, but I have met lots of people. It seems to have started among Brazilian expats, so particularly women, Brazilian women who have married American men, and who have some history with this religion. So that makes sense to me. But what I am puzzled about, I met a lot of Portuguese people last time I was in the Valley. Like, what is it about a cosmopolitan Portuguese man living in Lisbon? And I don't know what attracts those people. I think it offers different people different themes. But I'm curious, actually, because I spent all of my research time at the Mother Temple. I'm curious to see how things play out in other places, particularly outside of the film. I was not an actual participant in rituals because mostly, except as a patient, I would go through as a patient because you have to be initiated. And so I had several experiences. I've been going back there since 2010. And every time I go back, I have more access. And so the last time I was there was the summer in 2015. And I spent 6 months there in 2012. And when I went back in 2015, I and a photographer that I worked with who took a lot of these photos, we made photo books for people that we had spent a lot of time with, and we gave them to people. And the president, who is Aunt Neva's son, loved it. And that opened a lot of doors. So that was really the key. And from that point on, he allowed me to attend almost any ritual that I wanted to, that would not be open to outsiders, certainly not anyone who, you know, would, like, I wouldn't wear the costumes, because that's a big thing. Like, certain rituals you don't attend unless you have the costumes, but I had his permission, so. So every time I go back, more doors open. But the Valley believes that you have to be invited to develop your mediumship, to join the community. And I never received an invitation. And if I did, I don't know what I would do. I mean, I don't know personally that I could do it wholeheartedly, and I believe that I would need to do that, you know, for myself. But I'm also one of those people, like, there are many ways to look at religious phenomena. I mean, one of the things I'm interested in is how religions function in people's everyday lives, and so you don't necessarily need access to ritual secrets. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, that was perfect.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, fascinating talk. I'm curious how much what you might know about the overlap between this group and other spiritualist or ayahuasca groups that are current and popular in Brazil today.
Yeah. So they're very anti-drugs and alcohol. So there's no overlap with Santo Daime or any of the ayahuasca groups. They're pretty, also, I wouldn't say hostile, but they do not approve of the Afro-Brazilian religions, which is what my earlier project was on. So
the gods and saints and spirits of those are not represented?
They are, but the Umbanda spirits, so the Umbanda spirits that are, and that's Afro-Brazilian, that are most highly valued at the Valley are the pretu velhos, who are the spirits of elderly black slaves, who are a big focus of Umbanda. And you do find caboclos, which are Indian spirits, at the Valley. And the Valley very much sees those spirits as positive and benevolent. Some of the other Umbanda pantheon, spirits of the streets, they see as lower level spirits. The Orishas they see as kind of evolved, highly evolved spiritual beings who don't manifest on earth any longer. So you do have saints, you do have Orishas, you do have other spirits from Umbanda incorporated in the pantheon. But there's not a lot of overlap between practitioners going to different places.
And do the Space Brothers have a bigger influence or lesser influence compared to all these other supernatural powers?
The Space Brothers?
Extraterrestrial, blah, blah.
It depends on who you talk to. So the more intellectually inclined members of the Valley like to talk a lot about, you know, there's the sort of origin, right? For most rank and file members, they might focus much more on the pretu velho spirits or spirits that are more even familiar to them from their own upbringing. And they don't really talk about the extraterrestrials too much.
Is that featured big in your title, the extraterrestrial galactic
side of things? Yeah, I mean, something about the Valley too. I've spent a fair amount of time there, and I'm still figuring out what was happening in the Valley. Like the first time I was there, it gave me a headache every single day. What is happening? So for some people, they're really important. Like, for example, if I can just show you another slide, which you might find amazing. How do I make it come back on? This is a painting of the extraterrestrials. Uh-huh. You might, if you're old enough, maybe recognize it. Very reminiscent of Star Trek. So, for some people, the extraterrestrials are really important, and you know they all have names, and they appear. Their names are down here. I'm talking about Stuart G, Stuart, Johnson, Blatha, Zados, Gork, and Adiki. So there are some there are some English words that appear. There's a spirit called Teacher. And some of these they're not Portuguese. Eric, Portuguese. And I'm not sure where those come from. But the extraterrestrials are talked a lot about in Mario Sassi's work. So he was the sort of theologian.
Do the people who become mentors after seeking healing tend to stay and raise their children in the community, or is there a lot of turnover?
That's a really hard question to answer. There are certainly lots of people who stay and raise their children. So there's a whole generation of people now in their 20s and 30s who were born in the Valley and who continue to be Valley members. The Valley really emphasizes free will, so you can come and go as you please. So I haven't tried to make any attempt to sort of track down people who sort of have left. There certainly are people who leave. And some people cycle back in, and some people don't ever come back. So it's a hard question to answer.
Mike, is any of their literature translated into English?
Not that I know of. No. You go online, which some of you might be doing as we speak. The Valley has a huge presence online, but almost all of it is in Portuguese. There's a Wikipedia. But none of the, to my knowledge, none of the kind of theological stuff.
This is a quick question. Where is the temple in the U.S.?
It is in Marietta, Georgia.
Field trip?
but it's what they call a pronto socorro, emergency room. So it's not a full temple with all of the rituals that happen at the mother temple. My impression is that it sort of started in someone's house, and it has now moved into some more public space, but they don't have a website or,
I guess.
But if you're interested, I can probably.
No, the follow-up question then, in terms of literature in English, so then you said that it was a mostly Brazilian expats, so then they're not sort of producing their own
Well, this is, language. This, yeah, this is the interesting question. So the last time I was in, at the Mother Temple, some people from the temple in Marietta approached me about translating things. And so my impression is that they have begun translating things because they have begun to attract a local population who's not Brazilian. And one of the things I got curious about, and this is the kind of project that just takes over your life and you can go in a zillion directions, and I haven't pursued this, but it sort of was interesting to me, how are they going to translate some of these super Brazilian concepts, preto value spirits, to be understandable to a whole different, African American population. And actually, Professor Adam and I were talking about that earlier.
Chelsea and the
death. Okay, I have two questions. One, so if you went through, you were there and you were a patient, did you get to make a costume?
No, you have to be invited to go through initiation in order to have access to the costumes. And you have to go through several different levels of initiation before you get to the really fancy ones, which I personally like.
And also, why exactly do they look down on Afro-Caribbean religions?
It's not so much that they look down on them, but they think that part of what is happening with Afro-Caribbean religions and African religions is animal sacrifice. And they think that that attracts a low level of spirit, these obsessing, suffering spirits that feed off of that, the energy of blood and sacrifice. So they come from this whole lineage that's prominent in Brazil of a kind of purified spiritualism that is constructed in many ways in opposition to the African religion. So there's some class and race issues, I think, that get built in early on in how people understand Afro-Brazilian religions. Although they venerate the orishas, who are the deities at the heart of Afro-Brazilian religions like Candomblé. But they are this purified. They're not the orishas who come to the world and possess people and have animal sacrifices in their name.
So it sounds like many people would be attracted to this because of the rejection of social class. Would you say that they've replaced that with a kind of spiritual class?
Oh, absolutely.
Just looking at the badges. And
absolutely, yeah. It's incredibly hierarchical and bureaucratic in a way that if you've ever been to Brazil, you will, and spent time there, you will recognize Brazil is incredibly bureaucratic and hierarchical. And so, yeah, I absolutely think that. Although, as I said in the topic, everyone has access, with some exceptions. So I didn't talk about this at all, but there are like 7 levels of initiation, and after that there are other higher initiations for men only that women don't have access to.
So in a sense, I mean, it's still a way of attaining higher class.
Yes. Okay. Yes. And then actually, they're very aware of who is where in the pecking order. So in every ritual, which makes them last for hours and hours, every participant will say their spiritual name, which basically is a recitation of a lineage, and that includes their exact position in the hierarchy. And it takes about a minute to actually say. So, yeah. So in that way, it's super mirroring Brazil, which is transposed to the spiritual.
Right. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more on how all of these different like kind of religious and spiritualistic elements met, like where you like pull mostly on the like Christianity and then on Hinduism, but where how these other things are like some parts of the Afro-Caribbean religions and African religions have mixed in.
So I think the key actually is theosophy. I think that provides this overarching theological framework that is at the heart of the valley and spiritualism. And then the Afro-Brazilian religions fit in very easily because they're spirit-oriented. And the extraterrestrials also sort of fit in with the theosophical notion of ascended masters who are from other planets.
So would you say like the, I guess the religious interpretation is kind of all accepting of what falls beneath its own framework if it's something that kind of jives with the general.
Yeah, it can be totally reinterpreted and plugged in. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And certainly, like, I mean, you can sort of see through the visuals, like, late 1960s, early 70s, like, Brazil is plugged in. I mean, the references to Star Trek, which played in Brazil, the kind of, even the color scheme, Aunt Neva was rocking a real late 1960s, early 70s Elvis type thing. I mean, her aesthetic really influenced the valley as well.
How would you characterize the relationship between the valley and like the surrounding community?
Yeah, so the valley started out like, during Aunt Neva's life, she bought this huge piece of land and they constructed the temple. Everything was donated. And she began giving members plots of land. And so initially it was only valley members living there. And then at some point, unbeknownst to her, her son started selling off land to people who weren't members. And that's kind of when it spiraled out of control. So today there is a tense relationship that can sometimes flare between, in the town itself, between Valley members and other people, because it's like a bedroom community of Brasília. So lots of people live there and commute to work in Brasília. And there have even been Protestant churches particularly that target the Valley, which has caused lots of problems as being, you know, demonic. So there's tension. I mean, in Brazil, more generally, people think it's kind of a wacky, kooky, but basically harmless cult.
It seems to me that some of these customs would be quite expensive for a street sweeper to find. So I'm wondering, you're saying that you can't tell who's a street sweeper and who's a lawyer, but it seems that there must be class divisions and who can afford to do this.
There are, and there's a whole wing at the Valley that provides, if you can't afford, they'll provide costumes for you, they'll provide a place to live for you, they serve 3 meals a day. And the costumes are all made to very specific, what's the word I want, you know, specific requirements in terms of what material is used and what is placed where. So you can't necessarily tell by looking at the quality of the fabric, say, or the adornments, because they're all pretty standardized. But certainly lots of people donate their time and their resources to the Valley. And to people who can't afford it, will have help. During her lifetime, Aunt Nick was very well known. The vice president of the country attended her funeral. So she had some highly placed patrons. And, you know, she didn't live lavishly, like nothing. As you can tell, I think if she had had more money, like the Valley architecture would be much grander. And I think I think it would affect people differently. Like, if you can imagine that, like, huge, right? It doesn't strike you as so mini golf course, I guess. You know? I mean, there's something really to be said for that, which is why when I start thinking about Brasília, which is like, you know, the scale of Brasília is enormous and it's all like white. And so it's beautiful and people think it's genius, right? But it had a much higher budget,
yeah.
Basically. And, you know, and a brilliant architect, which I will not say that.
Sorry, I have one more question, but okay. I was just really curious, how is Aunt Mabo regarded by the religion? Is she regarded as a, is she regarded sort of like Muhammad, is regarded as Islam, or is she placed somewhere like, I mean, clearly the people in the Valley believe in Jesus, so she's probably not quite as high as Jesus, but like, or is she like somewhere up on a Bell Rock Hubbard level, you know? Like, I just think
That's an interesting question. So they believe that she's now a spirit form, and that spirit has a name. But if you talk to people, particularly people who knew her, they always emphasize that she was a regular person. Like, I was very struck by when I talked to people who had known her, and then a generation that had never known her, and you see the mythologization process happening. Because for the people who didn't know her, she's almost like, you know, a divine being herself. Like, she's could solve anything, and she's charismatic. But for the people who know her, they're like, yeah, she smoked a pack an egg, and she loved to, you know, sing and dance. And she certainly was a woman who had a lot of charisma, and I think she certainly had some kind of psychic ability and was a healer, I believe. So she hasn't been like they don't think she's Jesus. When they do talk about her today, it's either when she was alive or the spirit they call Quatai Santo Yolito. And then it's just this abstract, kind of rarefied spirit.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I was just going to say, I think it's ironic that she's going back today and now she's viewed as a healer.
Yeah, it was the 70s, you know? Everyone smoked pot, but they effectively. You could smoke in your college classrooms. There were ashtrays on the desks.
Is there any cognitive dissonance between a woman founding the community and that women aren't allowed to proceed all the way up?
Yeah, that caused a lot of cognitive dissonance for me. But for the yes and no, depends on who you talk to, right? So built into the discourse is a lot of talk about complementarity and that women are necessary and women are needed, and the valley totally talks a lot about manipulating energy and that women have a certain energy and men have a certain energy and you have to have them both. And so there's constant talk about how women are very important and women are seen, I mean, it's very, and Anna was very traditional in her views of gender. So women are seen as being very maternal and very loving, and you need that kind of care, and that's what the woman brings. But she also set it up so that after her death, basically men are in control, and partly that plays on an idea that men have more rationality. And so some women don't see any problem with that at all, just like some women in the United States, right? And some women are discomfited by it. So.
You said that she was a former truck driver. How did she exactly acquire the resources to build such an institution? Did you just have wealthy patrons, or do you know how that worked?
She did have some wealthy patrons. I mean, lots of, it was really built by the community. So she had an orphanage for many years that had, I don't know what the maximum number, but well over 100 children that she was taking care of. So, I mean, she was outlaying a lot. So I don't think that she had access to like lots and lots and lots of money. I mean, I think that people contributed what they could, the community came together. I mean, lots of the things you see are built out of bricks and paint and tile. So it's not expensive materials. There are, being very organized and bureaucratic, there are these different phalanxes that are headed by women, and only women can head these phalanxes, and there's sort of the companion to the higher levels that men can occupy. So women do have access to leadership, but it's over other women, not over the community at large. But there isn't, aside from that, I can't think of any.
Listening to you describe how the community is originally constructed, it reminds me of stories that I hear about Canudos in the late 19th century and Antonio Montalegre, and how he brings these dispossessed people out of the monarchy into this utopian community. And I'm wondering, one, if that's a fair comparison, and two, not to be essentialistic about it, but it seems like Brazil is really a center for these really weird, wacko, new age type communities.
Yeah, I think it's a fair comparison. Absolutely. I mean, I think you could see, if you were so inclined, as yet another millenarian movement, like.
Yeah, would you use that? You'd use that word to describe this, a millenarian movement.
Yeah.
You would. That's fair.
Yeah. It is. I mean, they are very much focused on the, we're on the cusp of the third millennium. You know, they're unclear about, like, what is that exactly going to look like? But that urgency, that millennial feeling is certainly there. I'm sorry, what was your second point?
It seems like Brazil collects these. I mean, the Brazilians I know are really deep into New Age, which that this isn't like a one-off thing. Like across Brazil, it seems like a lot of Brazilians really like New Age types of mentalities.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, I think that Brazil has been really unjustly overlooked, and when we study religions, I mean, it's a fascinating country that has a similar heritage in some ways to the United States and very different than others, and has this incredible cultural effervescence and religious effervescence. Lots of people attracted to New Age. I mean, I don't know if it's more than in the U.S. We also have a pretty flourishing New Age, I mean, it's a very decentered community, but I think that's been hugely rising in Brazil. Like if you just look at some of the census, you know, the people who either claim no religion or, you know, religions that the census isn't actually recording, like has jumped in the last 20, 25 years. But lots of Brazilians actually would be also embarrassed maybe by this. Like I was corresponding with someone who was like, that is not an authentic religion, that is a low form of spiritism, and like, you know. So there are people who would be embarrassed by it.
That's a good question. It has struck maybe that there's a little bit of an echo of Carnival in the use of those costumes and the marching. Did you get that sense at all?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. There's this whole performative like pageantry about it, on certainly the colors, that is reminiscent of Carnival. I mean, it's not like Carnival insofar as it's very ordered and regimented. It's not like
But like if you took Carnival and put it into that kind of society that they imagine, this is what it would look like.
Yeah.
A rationalized Carnival.
Any other questions? Okay.
Were you able to make any video of the ritual?
I made lots of video. So my project is actually multimedia. So I have lots of videos of rituals and lots of photos. I've yet to do anything with
that. Oh, okay.
But the idea, actually, the ultimate project is a multimedia book. And so that you would, like, if I'm describing a ritual, like the ritual of the burning star, which I showed you briefly, that you would have, there would be a link and you could, if you wanted to, watch an edited version of the ritual.
Okay, so that means that they're very often for people coming there and videotaping it.
For the public rituals, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, I had permission to. There were some things I couldn't video. But almost every year they have a large ritual every year, and AP is there, National Geographic is there. So actually some of the things you can find in English are little pieces done by AP, or there's a program called Around the World in 80 Faiths that has a short section by the BBC on the Valley of Dawn, which is a little bit misleading. The guy was only there for an afternoon.
We gotta send Reza Aslan now.
Yeah, exactly.
What? I'm curious about the rituals. Is there a focus for getting into trance, chanting? Do they meditate, or what's going on in the ritual, do you think, is the central point?
Yeah, so they do talk about meditating. Like when you, if you were a medium and you went to the, you arrive at the temple, like the first thing you do is sit in a special room and meditate and sort of get into the mindset, and it's very hushed and quiet. There's not really like, singing. I mean, there's hymns that they broadcast, but the trance also seems to be pretty rationalized. Like, usually there's a part that's just discourse, like a guy will be talking. And then at a certain moment, like, the spirits are supposed to come, and you get your spirit. So, and it's pretty controlled. You're certainly not, like, dancing. Like, you might see some of that, and that's all.
Speaking in tongues, or
only lower level spirits. Yeah, and that would be a problem.
And what do they think of John of God? Is there any talk with that group?
interesting because John of God is only about 3 hours away. They don't really talk about John of God, but lots of people from John of God go to the valley, and I met a lot of them last time I was there, and I thought that was very interesting because none of them spoke Portuguese, and they were, some of them were doing the development courses to develop their mediumship, so they were unsatisfied with John of God. Mm. But, you know, I don't really know. As far as I know, there's not a particular history between the two.
Well, Derek was indicating that people he knew thought that they were kind of healers of last resort, that their healing really could do something if no one else could. Do they have that general reputation, or is that just a fluke?
No, I think they do. Yeah. People's sort of impressions